Welcome to week 4 of History 325. This week we look at the ancient Near East, including Mesopotamia, early Christianity, and the Byzantine Empire. The following presentation is part 1 of a 2-part presentation for this week. Please note that not every slide has narration. Mesopotamia means the land between the waters, that is, the land through which the Tigris and Euphrates rivers flow, the biblical land of Shinar, modern Iraq. Here's a map of the ancient Near East. On the right side to the east are the Tigris and Euphrates rivers. That's the area of Mesopotamia. Just to the east of those rivers is the area of modern Iran, which in ancient times at one point is known as Persia. To the northwest is Anatolia, which is now modern Turkey, and on its coast you see the famous city of Troy, and from New Testament times, Ephesus. From Neolithic times, Çatalhöyük. To the south, where you see Alexandria and Giza and Memphis, that is Egypt. And then near the middle, the area of modern Israel, Palestine, and Lebanon. In fact, this map gives the borders for the modern nations, but these are all ancient sites. This map focuses in on ancient Mesopotamia, ancient Sumer, in fact, which is the first area we will cover, and it is the beginning of civilization, as we know it anywhere on Earth. Important to note are the cities of Ur, that's spelled U-R, and you can see Babylon there, which comes into prominence later. Uruk, U-R-U-K, is also quite important. After looking at that map, one can note then the passage from Genesis, which mentions Nimrod and all the cities that he was involved with. The next two slides give a timeline for Mesopotamia, and these slides cover the more prominent kingdoms of that area. Civilization begins at Sumer, the earliest civilization of Mesopotamia. In fact, a very famous book by one of the great scholars on Sumer, Samuel Noah Kramer, is titled History Begins at Sumer. For this course, I'm using another of his books. We don't exactly know when the Sumerians arrived, but we know that their material culture extends back to around 5000 BC. So they were there a while before the advent of writing. Sumer is the beginning of Bronze Age civilization. So also is Egypt, because about the same time Egypt emerges as a great civilization. And we'll cover Egypt when we cover Africa. But certainly no civilization precedes Sumer of any great size. I have here a note about the Sumerians being list freaks. That's from my old Near Eastern history professor, Dr. Tammy Schneider, an Old Testament scholar and archaeologist, and her point is that the Sumerians wrote everything down. As I've noted, Samuel Noah Kramer wrote a book, History Begins at Sumer, and sometimes I like to paraphrase it, business as usual begins at Sumer. Uruk was one of the most important cities of Sumer. In the Bible it's called Erech, and it's quite ancient. And it was a large site. What's interesting to note is that all these cities in a sense, disappeared from history. But the Bible is well aware of their existence. Here at Uruk, we see the invention, or at least the adaptation, of the pottery wheel and the emergence of bronze metallurgy. And for the Sumerians especially, the emergence of writing and a bureaucracy to go with it. A large city, it was the city of the famous hero and ruler Gilgamesh. Yes, Gilgamesh of the famous Epic of Gilgamesh is an historical person. Sumer is made up of about a dozen city-states, and a city-state means that each city pretty much operated autonomously on their own. One of the most important institutions within each city was the temple complex. And there, the most important structure was the ziggurat, a pyramid-like structure. This slide also notes that even though the religious institution was important, there was a growing tension between the priests and religion, and on the other hand, the rising or emerging civil power. This is a quote from Emily Kurtz, very fine two-volume work on the ancient Near East. Here we see her basically stating how, in fact, Sumer was a civilization. One of the greatest things about ancient Mesopotamia is that so much writing has been preserved. In Mesopotamia was developed cuneiform writing. Cuneus means wedge or stylus. It was a useful way of writing on clay, and these clay tablets, which easily fit in the palm of a hand, were then baked and hardened, so they're like stone, and they have been preserved for the ages. Tens of thousands have been found. So many have been found that I understand that so much has still not been translated because there just aren't enough people with the knowledge and the time to translate these tablets. And, of course, what remains to be discovered in some of these is of interest. Of course, when we're studying the history of the Middle East, we are also looking at some of the greatest finds of archaeology. One of those great discoveries is called the Royal Tombs of Ur, wherein many fine artifacts were found. On the next couple of slides, I have some pictures of some of the more remarkable and noteworthy finds. I should also note, as this slide does, that I have actually seen some of these artifacts in person. Was merely 18 inches away from that gold fluted goblet. In the upper center you see Queen Puabi's headdress. It's gold, and the bull harp to the left is very famous with the lapis lazuli stones. Down below are scenes from the Epic of Gilgamesh. This is looking at the harp straight on. The beards A beard, by the way, in Mesopotamia is a symbol of power. The goat or ram in the thicket to the right was of immediate interest to people when it was first presented publicly, in that people immediately thought about the story of the sacrifice of Isaac. Around the time of 2350 BC, we detect, at least from what is extant to us today, the beginning of what we can call today empire building. And this begins with Lugal Zaggisi and his rulership over a group of cities, Uruk, Ur, and Uma in this case. One of the remarkable finds of Sumer, among all the texts, tablets, is these sweeping reforms of Uruk Agina. It must have been important because it's been found in triplicate. And I'll let you read through some of these reforms. They are quite interesting. Kramer, in fact, finds this to also be evidence of a growing split or disagreement between the church, between religion and the civil authorities, or what we might call today a church and state, or church versus state conflict. Of course, we use terms we're familiar with today. The most spectacular architectural achievement of the Sumerians was the ziggurat, a pyramid-like structure. Here's a list of some of the more noteworthy deities of the Mesopotamians. You'll see sometimes two names here. One name is the Sumerian, the other is the more Semitic Akkadian. Very well known here is the goddess Ishtar, the goddess of fertility. We'll encounter the god Shamash in a little bit, the sun deity, the sun god. In a number of cultures, the sun is the god of justice. It's the god who sees all. And Shamash is related to the word, or to the name, Samson. Down at the bottom, I've added a note about how the Greeks, much, much later, cylinder seals are a frequent artifact found in ancient Mesopotamia. They are not large, they're small, maybe inch and a half, inch long, and they were rolled over soft clay, let's say clay, a pottery vase, in order to identify the owner. You can see the Mesopotamian myth being played out pictorially here, and also some cuneiform writing. While Lugal Zaggisi didn't get too far in his empire building, the next group of rulers to come on the scene in Mesopotamia surely did. This is the Akkadian kingdom. Now, the Akkadians had been around. In the Sumerian tablets, during the Sumerian period, which we've just moved out of technically and into the Akkadian language is present. So the Akkadians and the Sumerians, whatever distinction there is between the two, other than linguistically, they appear to live together in the southern part of Mesopotamia. It is a multicultural group of city-states. Now, the Akkadians speak a Semitic language, Akkadian. Semitic languages include Arabic and Hebrew. The great ruler, the first great ruler of the Akkadians, is Sargon the Great. Sargon means legitimate king, which means he probably wasn't. But he rose up through the ranks and became the thing of legends, and set up a kingdom, or certainly influence, running all the way from Mesopotamia to the Mediterranean Sea. Sargon reigned a long time, 56 years, and like other rulers of Mesopotamia, would set up his family members in various cities throughout Mesopotamia. His daughter Enheduanna was installed as the cultic bride at Ur. Ur is a city where the focus especially is on the moon god. Ur is famous as being the place where Abraham came from. Enheduanna, in fact, is the earliest known literary figure, the person whose name we know, earliest in time, who composed literature of some sort, and she composed poetry. Note that she wrote her poetry in Sumerian, even though she was Akkadian, because Sumerian is kind of like Latin to the church, the Catholic Church at this time. That is the It is a higher cultured language. Later came Naram-Sin, Sargon's grandson. This is the high point of the Akkadian Empire. And he too, after the Akkadians, there was a renaissance of Sumerian culture. This is called by the archaeologists Ur III. Sumerian, like Latin, is rather a dead language at the time, but it is what the cultured, the educated, are learned in. An important ruler during this time is Ur-Nammu, who built a significant ziggurat. Also from this time, you'll see on the slide, is the earliest extant law code known, and it is by Shulgi. Some people think it's the law code of Hammurabi is the earliest, but that's not the case. The earliest one we have is by Shulgi, and then earlier we saw significant legal reforms in an even earlier document. When the Epic of Gilgamesh was first discovered among the clay tablets, it was a scholarly curiosity because of its strong parallels in places to the flood. Although the term Babylon is often used to label the area of Mesopotamia, it really, north of the area of the Babylonian kingdom, was the old Assyrian kingdom. We say Old Assyrian because the Neo-Assyrian kingdom, much later, is what is another important manifestation of the Assyrians. In fact, it's the one famous in the Bible, and we'll get to that shortly. Old Assyrian is the northern dialect of Akkadian. So you can see Akkadian is still very much a living language, certainly the language of commerce in the ancient world at this time, in the Near East. I would like to note that the dates on this slide are pretty wide-ranging, and the gist to take away from this slide is that the Assyrians were there very early in the second millennium and continued on through the whole millennium. Now, before continuing, I just want to once again direct your attention to a map. And you can see here in the east, Babylonia to the south, and there's Sumer next to it. Sumer is a more ancient culture. Babylonia comes along with the old Babylonian kingdom. North of that is Assyria. Then over to the west, up above, you see the Hittite Empire in Anatolia, modern Turkey. Then we're going to pay attention a little bit to not only the Hittites, but also down along the coast north of present-day Israel. You see Ugarit, Byblos, Sidon, and Tyre. And over just to the east of Ugarit is Ebla. 100 years ago or so, the Hittites were thought to actually not exist. True, they were in the Bible, but with biblical criticism at that time, it was thought that they were probably some kind of made-up group of people. Well, the archaeologists have shown not only did the Hittites exist, but they were a great power. And you can go to some places such as Harvard and learn the Hittite language. The Hittites were very much involved in the general international relations of the area at this time. You can see the dates there. Note that the Hittites are not a Semitic-speaking people, but are Indo-Europeans. I want to note just a few settlements in the area of the Levant. In the ancient Near East, the Levant is a term that refers to basically the Syro-Palestine area, that is, from the border of Egypt up through present-day Israel, Lebanon, and then Syria. And Syria not only goes north, but spreads out toward the east, toward the Euphrates River. That is the Levant. Significant establishments all throughout this area. One thing to note is that Damascus, you may have heard it said that it is probably the oldest city in the world, and it goes way, way back into Neolithic times. And so too does Jericho, a famous town in the Bible. A wall and tower there, still extant, date to about 7500 BC. But moving into the area we're covering, an area contemporaneous with Mesopotamian civilization, that is the Bronze Age, and we're still in the Bronze Age here, is especially Ebla and the settlements of Canaanites. On this map, you can see a number of the places I've just noted, such as Jericho, and to the north of it, Damascus. And you see Ebla near the top, and Ugarit near the coast. And I'm going to speak on Ugarit and Ebla here shortly. Some scholars knew of a city named Ebla from some of the ancient tablets, but knew nothing else about it. And then the city itself was discovered, and it turned out to be quite a large and important city of its time. So here was a city that was forgotten to history, just like the Hittites, and then later discovered to be significant, and a large archive of tablets with writing was discovered. Another significant discovery was Ras Shamra along the coast, way up in Syria. It was a Canaanite settlement, and the language was also Semitic, just like at Ebla. The discoveries at Ugarit are somewhat later than Ebla, that is the significant writings found there. But already there seems to be an alphabet forming. The alphabet comes from these Western Semitic peoples. And something like an alphabet is appearing at Ugarit. The importance of Ugarit to Old Testament studies cannot be overstated. In fact, it has been written that the tablets discovered at Ugarit are second only to the Dead Sea Scrolls in helping us understand the language and culture of the Old Testament. here are some of the deities that we associate with this western part of the Near East, especially if significance is Baal or Baal, well known from biblical texts, and Ashtoreth or Astarte, the goddess of fertility, the queen of heaven. I believe the word, the name, is linguistically connected to Ishtar, and it is very much, the goddess is very similar to Ishtar over in Mesopotamia. Toward the end of the Bronze Age, significant changes occur in the Near East and the Mediterranean. A period known as the Dark Age emerges from about 1100 to 800 BC. During that period, that 300 or so year period, there is no major civilization. Egypt remains, but even it is kind of diminished for a while in influence. No one knows for sure what triggered all these changes, but this slide notes a number of changes that occurred. The collapse of the Mycenaean Greek civilization, that's the world that Homer writes about, the world of Achilles and of Odysseus. Troy collapses, and it's about this time that the war between Greece and Troy that Homer wrote about, or he didn't write, his poetry was recited. His poetry is about that war. That's about the time the war occurred. But it's not seen that the war necessarily brought on all these changes, but it was part of the changes that occurred. The Hittite kingdom was destroyed. At Ugarit, it appears that, well, Ugarit was destroyed, and inside one of the ovens baking a tablet to harden it was even found in a writing that said, "The boats are gone." Egypt lets go of its control over the Palestine area. And during this Dark Age, there is a move toward iron technology over against bronze. So the Bronze Age ends and the Iron Age begins. There are some other things that occurred, such as the migration of Greek-speaking peoples to the coast of Asia Minor, becomes known as Ionia. Akkadian, as the lingua franca, as the language of international trade, goes away, and in its place arises another Semitic language, Aramaean, from which we get Aramaic. And we see a few small states or kingdoms emerge on the scene in this vacuum created by this period. And those states include Israel and Judah, which we well know from the Bible, as well as the Phoenicians. And during this time, and often associated with this bringing on this period of destruction and change, is what is known as the invasion of the Sea Peoples. And this information comes from the Egyptians. They were attacked by a group of people, many peoples actually. And one of those peoples has been clearly identified as the Philistines. So we'll look at a few of these now. I would like to add here that the collapse of Greek Mycenaean culture was so devastating that the Greeks had to relearn writing. That is, before the collapse, Mycenaean Greece wrote in what is known as Linear B script. After the collapse, hundreds of years later, Greek writing emerges again in the archaeological record, this time utilizing an alphabet they received from the Phoenicians. One of the most significant cultures to emerge after the Dark Age is the culture of the Phoenicians. Now, the Phoenicians are not a nation. They are a number of independent cities that are well known for seafaring trade. Cities such as Tyre and Sidon and Byblos. Byblos is where we get the word for Bible. The Phoenicians are a continuation of Canaanite culture, and they are very closely related to the Hebrew people, both linguistically and in many ways culturally. And I've noted there at the bottom of this slide just how closely they are associated at times with Israel. One of the great innovations of the Western Semites was the invention of the alphabet. On this slide, I have three alphabets. The first is most of the alphabet we use. We call these Latin letters. Below that row is the Greek equivalent for each letter, and below that is the Hebrew equivalent for each letter, if there is an equivalent. I've tried to line them up as close as I can. Please note that the Hebrew alphabet is actually written backwards. It should run from right to left, but in order to line things up, I have it going the direction of the Greek and Latin alphabets. Below these are the names of the letters. And if you look at the Hebrew letter Aleph, you'll see below it the Greek word Alpha. And the Hebrew letter Bet or Beth, you'll see Beta in Greek. Gimel and Gamma, and Dalet and Delta. It is obvious that someone has gotten the alphabet from someone else. And we know that the Greeks have gotten it from the Phoenicians, and as I've noted earlier, the Phoenicians are closely related to the Hebrews. In fact, Alpha and Beta and Gamma and Delta have no Greek meaning other than the names of letters, whereas in Hebrew, Aleph means ox, Beit or Beth means house, such as Bethel, house of God, Bethlehem, house of bread, Gimel is camel, and Dalet is door. So in Hebrew, the letter names actually come from particular objects, whereas in Greek, they have merely taken those names from the Phoenicians. As was noted before, the Philistines were one of the peoples of the sea that attacked the Egyptians at the end of the Bronze Age. Also in this early Iron Age period is the establishment of the kingdoms of Israel and Judah. What is interesting to note about these two kingdoms is that in the Assyrian documents of the time, they are never linked together. Israel is usually mentioned as in league with Samaria and the Phoenician cities of Tyre, Sidon, and Byblos, and Damascus in Syria, while Judah is usually associated with Ashkelon, Gaza, the area of the Philistines, and Moab and Edom. Two Mesopotamian Iron Age empires include the Neo-Assyrian and the Neo-Babylonian or Chaldean empires. The Neo-Assyrian was a very warlike kingdom that captured the northern kingdom of Israel in 722 BC. And then later it, in turn, was defeated by the Neo-Babylonian or Chaldean Empire by the father of Nebuchadnezzar. And then Nebuchadnezzar ascended to the throne, and he was responsible for destroying Jerusalem and its temple around 587 BC. The final Mesopotamian culture to cover in this presentation is the Persian Empire, technically just to the east of Mesopotamia. A very large empire that was well run, a very efficient bureaucracy. I note on this slide the Behistun inscription, which is written on the side of a mountain in stone, that is the key a significant religion embraced by the Persians of that time is Zoroastrianism. It is Zoroastrianism that introduces the concept of a great war between good and evil taking place on planet Earth. And in fact, some would say that the figure known as Ahriman is the first time the figure we know as the devil emerges within religious consciousness. Zoroastrianism is also interesting and at that time unique in that it doesn't see history as cyclical like the Greeks saw history, you know. And the Hindus also saw history. It runs its course and then it repeats itself. But the Zoroastrians see it as more of a timeline with a beginning and then a final day. In other words, kind of something along the lines of biblical eschatology. One of the great gifts of the Hebrews is the concept of monotheism. That is, the concept of only one God, and that that God is a personal God. There are a number of names for God in the Hebrew Bible. First and foremost is the one spelled with the four Hebrew letters there on the slide, which is often pronounced Yahweh. In English translations, it is usually written as Lord, and all the letters are capitalized. Adonai, when it appears in the Hebrew text, is translated into English as Lord with only the first letter capitalized. Jehovah is a name for God where the consonants are taken from Yahweh and the vowels are taken from Adonai. And another name for God is Elohim. And when that appears in the Hebrew Bible, it is translated into English as God with a capital G. Here's a brief history of Israel from the time of the patriarchs in the Bronze Age through Moses and the Exodus, and the kingdoms of the Iron Age, Judah and Israel, and finishing just after the time of Jesus. The two great contributions of the Hebrews to culture and world thought are monotheism, that is belief in one more than 100 years before Jesus. The Hebrew Bible was translated into Greek because the Jewish people had spread out throughout the Mediterranean area, and Greek was at that time the lingua franca of the Mediterranean superculture. So there was a need for a Bible in the Greek language. The Septuagint, often designated with the Roman numerals for the number 70, was that translation. Why 70? Because traditionally 70 or 72 translators were thought to have worked on it. So here's the first part of Genesis, in Greek. It should be noted that it is the Septuagint often that the early church, even the New Testament writers, are using when referring to the Old Testament. The Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered just after World War II, an extremely significant find, considered one of the greatest of all archaeological discoveries, and one of the most significant things about the Dead Sea Scrolls is that they took our knowledge of the Hebrew Bible, as far as extant copies, back 1,000 years or so before the earliest manuscript we already had of the Hebrew Bible, and thus demonstrated that the Hebrew Bible over a very long period of time changed very insignificantly, remained essentially constant over time. The Apocrypha are those books of the Bible that were not in the original Hebrew Bible, but they often are part of the Greek Septuagint, that is the Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible. They're additional books written during the period that Christians refer to as the intertestamental period, the period between the ending of the prophets and that era and the time of Jesus. These books are often found in Roman Catholic Bibles and were originally part of the King James Version. The pseudepigrapha are those literary works that lie even further outside the Christian and Hebrew canons, but they are considered significant religious writings for the time. First Enoch is prominent among them, and a whole text of it was not known until an Ethiopian translation was discovered, written in Ethiopic.